documented his minors.
How about everyone? It's an honor for me to acknowledge country today. I stand here as a proud Gadigal and Yalanji man, and I acknowledge country and ask you to do the same wherever you are. You do not have to be from this country to acknowledge country. So it's an honor to recognize the Wagga Kaba and Bengal people of this nation and to honor the land on which we're learning today. So thank you very much.
A quick message from the groups that have actually sponsored this today. Now, first, invite Dinity and the people from the Sante group to come forward and just say a little bit about their group.
Hello everyone. Firstly, thank you for coming, like Peter said. We're from a group called JC Club Professionals for Refugees and Asylum Seekers. Basically, we're a group that started this year, and we're basically just advocating for refugees and asylum seekers and the role that health professionals can play in the care of these people.
Yeah, so just a few of the events that we've had this year include just fundraising, Refugee Week, which is currently going on, and we've got that display outside, so you should all go and check out. Letter writing to children in detention, letter writing to MPs, and we also had a mental health Q&A with Jakunza for the first time this year, and that also addressed issues with refugees and asylum seekers.
And this year we're also in the process of starting up a primary preventive healthcare program called Healthy Start. Hopefully it should be up and running by next year. Basically it's just sort of advocating primary healthcare and access to GPs and those things for newly arrived refugees in Townsville. And yes, and this is the rest of the group. This is Maria. And has name. My mind just blanked, really. But yeah, again, thank you for coming out and I hope you enjoy the night.
I apologise to you, I didn't introduce myself. I'm Peter Hanley from the Local Amnesty Group. Invite Meg from the Council Multicultural Support Group.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much. We were very happy to partner with Sante and Amnesty International for this important lecture. Thank you, Kon. And I'm just aware there are members of the management committee here and members of TMSD and volunteers here. If you'd like to stand up. I was pretty impressed with those years. So. The Council Multicultural Support Group is the lead settlement agency for the settlement of refugees and migrants in Townsville. And we do have some minimal support available for people who are asylum seekers, but not many come through here, but those that do, we're very, very aware of their vulnerability and the impact that the meanness of our government has on their lives and their potential to feel a sense of belonging or to feel that they can plan for any hope or future. So we look forward to hearing from you, Kon, and thank you, everyone.
And the third group is Amnesty International, and actually two Amnesty groups, the campus JCU Amnesty group and also the council group. This is the fourth year we've held this lecture, and we're really happy to see such a great crowd here. We do a number of things. Both groups are always keen to get new members. At the end, I'll say a little bit about how you might want to contact us. Some of the things we do, we have a monthly vigil outside, it's actually now the new member for Herbert's office, outside the office now, Cathy O'Toole, who's actually seen our vigil on Friday mornings. Hands up. Oh, that's good, yeah. Yeah, okay. So how many people there on a Friday morning? Probably most, yeah. So come along, it's always a nice, we give up half an hour a month, and we think that's not too much to give up for people who are, in pretty tragic circumstances. We do a lot of letter writing. Amnesty began as a letter writing organisation, writing on letters on behalf of human rights. People who are suffering from human rights deprivation, writing on behalf of prisoners of conscience. So once a month we come together in a Thai restaurant to write letters, and our reward at the end is we have a Thai meal. So it's a good social group. And we also run a number of campaigns. And our two main campaigns at the moment, the refugee campaign, which has been ongoing now for about 5 years, and also Community is Everything, which is looking at Indigenous rights, particularly the rights of young people and the high rates of incarceration of young people in the juvenile justice system. So if you're interested in those things, It's easy enough to find. I'll just remind you at the end how you can contact all the groups that were mentioned today. And so now the very important business of drawing the raffle. I'll call our raffle organiser. Heather, are you going to come in?
You got green, this could be your night. Green D56. Green D56, come on down. Anyone, come on. D56 green. All right. Oh, you sure? Ah, yeah, we're going to.
The Council Agency Group and the MCJCU Group are really proud and really happy to have this lecture every year. And I think to emphasise the real importance of human rights. Growing up in Australia, most of us take human rights, I won't say for granted, but we all know the human rights are there and human rights are in the background. But it's quite sobering to realise that all this awareness of human rights really just began at the end of the Second World War. And at the end of the Second World War, they realised there were countries in the world where it was quite legal for governments to kill their own citizens. And I won't go into the details, I know the horrific things that happened during World War II. So at the end, the nations of the world together came together and said, this can never happen again. And so that strong movement came with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and all the other supporting covenants. So it's really important that we really hold on to this and remember how important human rights are, and that we don't give up those rights easily. We don't give up those rights at all. So it's really great to have Kon. He's a great human rights advocate. Come to Council this evening to present the lecture. Just a little bit about Kon. He's the CEO and founder of the Asylum Seeker Resource Centre in Melbourne. Have a look at their website. If you get a chance, we'll send that link out to people who come to the lecture. It's a great organisation. According to the website, on the website it says 12,000 people have actually benefited, been helped by people from the Asylum Seeker Resource Centre. Started as a shop front, and through the energy of Kon and the other early founders, they built that up into a great service that now helps so many people. Kon is proudly Greek. He grew up in a working class family, a small country town. His personal experience of racism, witnessing the exploitation of his parents in factories, planted the seeds for his passion for human rights. Kon went on to become a lawyer, a social worker and a teacher. Recently he was awarded the Order of Australia, the OAM Medal in 2011. So I just ask you to join me.
And thank you to all the wonderful groups who have invited me here tonight, and thank you for the lovely introduction. Is that too loud? Is that okay? I really hate this. I feel like a cross between Oprah and Madonna. If you want to be part of the conversation online, hashtag human rights, because likewise, if you can't get around to asking me a question tonight, which we'll make time for, I promise to respond to you on Twitter as well. So hashtag human rights, and I'd love to get your feedback on tonight. I want to start by paying my respects to the fact that we are on the land of First Nations people. And apologies a little bit off the paper, but I want to pay respects to the Bindal people and the Wurrungkaba people. They're the traditional custodians of this land. And every time when I think and talk about the rights of refugees, how can you possibly have that conversation without talking about the human rights of First Nations people? It's quite an extraordinary thing that the one community that consistently welcomes refugees are Indigenous people in this country. And yet, I so often hear from Indigenous people how this country makes them refugees in their own country. How, in 2016, are we still stuck in tokenistic conversations around recognition when we should be allowing Indigenous voices, Indigenous self-determination, Indigenous autonomy to actually be talking about treating this country? And it is appalling when you look at, you know, recently people were looking at Dongdao and going, why did they get a Royal Commission? And why not the Nauru files? And it was a really critical moment when I was looking at that. Because what was so important was to understand that we're in the same fight. And it's so important we don't turn on each other. And what you saw in Dongdao is what's been happening to Indigenous people for centuries in this country. It was just that it was on film that forced action. So for us, intertwined and tied to justice and human rights for our newest Australians is impossible unless we do justice by our first people. And I do think they're inextricably linked together, as is any conversation, whether it's climate change or any issue around human rights. And I just think we should always start by paying that respect and by recognising the honour and privilege of actually being connected to a culture, a people that is 60,000 years old is an extraordinary, precious gift. I'm going to tonight just do storytelling. And at some point you're just gonna tell me to stop and then we'll go to questions because I never prepared anything. But I wanna talk about values and I wanna talk about stories. When I talk about human rights, you're not gonna hear me lecturing you about international law, and I'm not gonna be presenting any sections of any act because it's kind of, it's not bullshit, but it's not actually going to win. And what I'm really interested in is talking about where we are, but I'm really interested in talking about how we can win, how we can actually succeed, and how things could be different and better. I might start with my own journey around human rights, because one of the things I always hope when I talk is that it encourages other people who are passionate to know that that passion is a beautiful, precious thing that people are going to try to knock out of you always. So for me, in terms of where my story begins, I mean, it has so many different points to it. I can think of my parents who came here by boat in the 60s as migrants, sacrificed everything, gave up their dreams. You know, my father at the age of 9, you know, had to go out and work the fields to raise a dowry for his sister. My mum at the age of 12. And it really struck me because today Scott Morrison was coming out and talking about what a burden the parents of migrants are. And how if they don't speak English, they should only get temporary visas. And I thought about my parents, people who couldn't speak a word of English, but somehow raised two human rights lawyers who, between them, hold an All of Australia, 8 university degrees. Apparently my illiterate, uneducated parents had nothing to contribute. I think about my grandparents, more and more I think about my grandmother and grandfather, my father's side, who themselves were refugees, and they experienced what's called the Bunyan genocide in Greece in the early 1900s, and experienced and survived the Nazis occupying their little village. And I think of my grandmother, who raised 7 children, what a heroine, what an extraordinary woman.
Where was the genocide, Greece or Turkey?
Greece, it's the Bunyan genocide. And I think about that and go, there was a time where she would have been spoken of as a hero, you know, worthy of a statue, of such prowess that, you know, Zeus himself should bow down to her knees. And I think about how would my grandmother be spoken of now? How would my mother and father be spoken of now? I want you for a moment to just look around this room. And I want you to close your eyes for a moment. And I want you to think about, I want you to think about who sacrificed everything for your human rights. Who gave up everything for your human rights. Whose acts of courage and selflessness gives you the opportunity to be here with me tonight. Who crossed the seas or borders or land. If you're First Nations people, how your people have endured for thousands of years and centuries since we've had invasion in this country. And if you're everyone else, which is boat people, all of you, what gave you the freedom you taste tonight? The democracy you can express tonight? Whose act of courage and sacrifice was that? For me, you can open your eyes. I want you always to start there, and I'm always starting there now because I think about that story is the story of the refugees that I work with. Stories of heroism, sacrifice, resilience, courage, entrepreneurship, bravery, searching for safety, searching for that better life, one free of oppression and harm. When you think about your parents or grandparents or great-grandparents, what do they mean to you? Do you see burden, problem, risk, threat, danger, any of you? Those stories are passed down, aren't they? It's like rituals. And I bet there's a little part of all of you that in what you're studying or the work you're doing right now is you trying to honor that. I always think of that for me. I'm that living legacy. I'm that living legacy for my father, who sadly passed when I was in my 20s. I'm the living legacy of that for my mother, trying to leave a little footprint of humanity to make this world a little kinder, a little gentler, a little fairer. I tell you that because I want you to think about when you're hearing these conversations around people seeking asylum and the way in which they are demonized, vilified, objectified, and dehumanized, they're actually talking about your story too. At a time when we politicize the bodies of people that are not white, of brownness and blackness, it's politicized, it's dehumanized. That if you happen to be Muslim, it's criminalized. Look around at the diversity in this room. And how many of you are spoken of as an asset to this country, as precious to this country? Not most of you, I can tell you that. Not right now. Most of you are seen as a burden, as a problem, as a threat to white privilege, to male privilege, as we keep disrupting so many spaces and push for human rights and equality. And it's extraordinary right now in 2016 that we're still debating marriage equality, that we can have, 10 women killed in the last 42 days by male violence, more than all Australians killed by terrorism in the last 42 years in Australia. And yet women's services are being defunded while we spend billions on a fictitious war. Because women's lives actually don't matter. We can't commodify to win votes based on fear. That's why refugee lives matter so much in politics. Because it gives you a story that should be one of heroism and bravery and courage, and says we can whip this up into fear. I want you to close your eyes one last time, and I want you to think about the darkest, worst moment in your life. I'm not going to ask you to share it, I just want you to be there for a moment. Think about you at your lowest, you at your most overwhelmed, you at your most precarious, fragile, despairing self. And that could have been caused by anything. I just want you to sit with that for a moment. Open your eyes. I want people just to shout out to me, not what happened, but what did you need at that time, such as, I need compassion. What did you need or what helped you at that time? Just shout out a couple of words.
For a start?
What else?
A feed.
Feed? What else?
Empathy.
Empathy? What else?
Justice.
Hugs.
Understanding.
Now imagine in that moment in time, that was your defining identity forever. That you at your most desperate is going to actually be the only way this room will ever see you again. The rights you have, the way you're spoken of, the way that you're treated, the way that you're seen is based on that prism of suffering, of that moment in time. Who wants that for the rest of their life? Anyone? Anyone want to sign up for that? Well, this is what we do to refugees. We take a moment in time where through no fault of their own, people are forced to flee to save their families, and we take this moment and we build a narrative. We build a narrative of problem, of threat, and of burden. And think about how humiliating and degrading it would be if that was the line that you were forced to identify with. I should apologize in advance, I'm not going to swear a few times in this lecture as well. Always return to yourself. Because if you can't tolerate it for you, and if you can't tolerate it for your family, then why the hell is it good enough for anyone else? So the first tenet of human rights is personal accountability. That is, don't champion or speak for anything you yourself couldn't bear or accept. Before, you're saying the things you would have loved in your moment of crisis was empathy, welcome, feed, compassion, understanding. That's all people seeking asylum are seeking. That's all they're seeking. And yet, as a country, it seems to be too high a price. Compassion, decency, caring for people. I'm going to come back to this in about 5 minutes. But I might take a step back and just start with my own little journey. One thing I want to encourage everyone in the audience, if you're passionate about human rights, and you should be because we're talking about your rights as well, is be fearless, be brave, be curious, understand that most people are never going to get you, and the worst thing you could want in life is to fit in. You've got to find your own little space, but don't compromise that. Now, when I was growing up, a little country town called Mount Beauty, 1,500 people, my parents were tobacco farmers, all I kept being told every day was, like, F off back to my own country, you dirty wog, you filthy wog, you dirty wog. People even had limericks after my name. And you know, to this day, every day someone's mocking my name, Kon Karapanagiotidis. And I just sit there now when like people do that to me and go, imagine being mediocre and having Smith or Jones as your name. I just say that now. My name has thousands of years of culture behind it. I'm proud of where I come from. But at that young age, it crippled me. Like, this thing of that my identity, my ethnicity, that myself somehow was less than, wasn't as worthwhile. And we were moving from the country to Melbourne when I was about 12. And I hated high school, got bullied every day. And I really did not want to stay on this earth. You know, the darkness, I remember going home and just crying, just trying to cry myself to sleep. Of going, why can't I make sense in this world? Why can't I fit in anywhere in this world? And I hated myself so deeply. And I yearned so much to just belong and to find a place. And I look back at that time, and while, you know, I'd rather not have gone through it in one way, I actually don't regret any of it. Because those moments either break you or they actually teach you some of the most valuable things in life. Empathy, resilience, compassion, and understanding of what it's like to be the other. And when I was in high school, I was always told, you know, of course nothing would become of me. Right? My teachers telling me to drop out of school. I'm just going to end up in jail. When we were at university, I was having teachers in it going, oh, you're just so idealistic, Kon. And if you can just get rid of that fire in your belly, you're going to be okay, Kon. And when people tell you that stuff, never listen to them. The line of people telling you what you can't do is for them. And they're the people that have signed on to, I have given up on life. I have given up on my imagination, my passion, the best of myself. I have let fear triumph over me. That's what those people are. I was 18 and I was sitting there going, I make sense nowhere in this bloody world. And I just started doing volunteer work. And I started volunteering at a homeless men's shelter. And I was hating my first year of uni, couldn't make friends. No one likes me. I'm not asking for people to sing. It's an objective fact, no one likes me. And I'm quite divisive creatures, there's still most people don't like me, it's okay. And I started volunteering at a homeless men's shelter, and I finally found a place that I belonged. Here were these men who had lost everything and anything. And they were reaching into their own pockets, giving me their last dollar. You know, I was a shabby dresser then, I'm a shabby dresser now. They thought I was homeless and I'd be out doing what they could. And over the next 10 years, what I did is I just went out there and I just threw myself into everything that I had a passion for. And that's one of the most important things I can encourage you to do. Fear is the most beautiful thing, because fear is telling you, this is what I want, this is what I yearn for or desire, but I don't think I'm good enough, or I don't think I'm smart enough or worthwhile enough to make that possible. And so what I've done is take that fear and throw myself into everything that terrifies me. And it's been one of the most liberating and beautiful things to do. And over those first 10 years, I just went out there and experimented. You know, and it was incredible. From working with homeless men, to outreaching, working with sex workers, to spending my Sundays playing with terminal ill children at the children's hospital, to being at the end of the phone at midnight answering phone calls of suicidal people, to running support groups for male survivors of child abuse. And I was looking at all of these journeys, and I was wondering how all these people on the outer, they're so resilient and resourceful and courageous, and yet they're seen as worthless. They're seen as worthless. And it doesn't surprise me. Today, the front page of The Australian is, migrant parents cost the economy $3.2 billion. I missed the part about, where's that part about how parents give you love and role models and community and culture and connection and support and nurturing and break down isolation? No. It's this. Fuck everything else. Here's the price tag on it. Forget everything else. We're not a community. We're an economy. There's a number you can place on anything. And that experience of just being out there gave me so much sense of purpose and connection around. There's this incredible community out there where you can take all the stuff that you think is going to make you worthless and unlovable and never make anything of yourself. You can take all of that and you can flip it. That is, you can take adversity and hurt and grief and you can lead with love and you can lead with passion and compassion and empathy. And it's the most extraordinary blessing to actually be out there in communities where people are entrusting you with their dreams and their lives and their hopes, and they're letting you in. Most of what we're consumed with in life is bullshit. Like, you know, yeah, education has its place because it gives you power and access. But the material world is meaningless. The things we yearn and grieve and desire is intimacy, it's community, it's people. Human rights is about people. And the idea and the aspiration that all of us in this room together tonight are seen as of equal worth and potential and possibility. So I'm 28 and I'm teaching at a TAFE. And my students have to do something for class. And I'd started working with people sitting inside in my community who were going without food. And so I said to my students, how about we change the world? How about we start our own charity as our TAFE class project? How about we do that? I had a little shop front that my mate wasn't using, about, I don't know, maybe the size of this. Furniture from my mum's, a couple hundred bucks in my pocket. And in 8 weeks, as a TAFE project, the Asylum Seeker Resource Centre began. That's a little food bank in Footscray, in a 20 square metre shop front. And all I was trying to do was teach my students that at any time, you can change the world. That our empathy and our compassion is really powerful. You can transform the world at any time, just by having a go. And when I started the centre, people said this cannot work. You cannot run an organisation that will never take federal government funding. You cannot run an organisation that relies on volunteers predominantly. You cannot be outspoken on human rights and do service delivery. This model does not work. And people mocked me and laughed at me. And the thing, when you're in this space, is the more people tell you what you can't do, the more you need to stick it to them. And the more you need to prove people wrong. And you need a simple soundtrack, which is, this only fails if I let it fail. And then a deeper narrative, which is, I actually can never fail. We're so consumed in this idea of failure. How can you ever be a failure by living your values, standing up for what you believe in, and being brave and fighting for that? How can you ever lose your values? How can you ever fail? You can't. 15 years later, the ASRC, by early next year, will have 4 centres across 3 states, has 112 paid staff, 3 social enterprises, 1,300 volunteers, a couple of thousand on the wait list, 30 different programs, a $10 million physical budget, that's about $40-50 million a year of free assistance. And under this one roof, it's this beautiful community. Our major center is about 20 times the size of this room. And it's surreal. It's beautiful. Every day we have everything from 5-year-old kids who have done lemonade stands on the weekend coming in with a piggy bank, to grandmothers who are needing winter blankets and coats. I start every morning with a room full of volunteers talking about where we're going and how we're going to change the world. And everything that people told me would be my failure was the foundation for my success. Have an authentic voice, be fearless, stand for something that you believe in, don't compromise, have integrity. And that will always get tested. That will always get tested. Before I started the ASRC, every job I had before that, I'd been sacked from, every job. And at the time, it was awful getting sacked. And 2 of those jobs were at universities. One was a disability advocate, and I threatened the university with taking me to the Human Rights Commission because I was discriminating against students. And then the second one was for starting the ASRC as a tech project because the university thought it was too political. Each time I could have saved my job, and each time I had a decision to make between, do I give up my values and my integrity to save a job? And each time I chose my values. I share that with you because it's really important to know you can always get another job, but you can't get back your values. Both those universities, subsequently, both gave me the second most prestigious award about a decade later. And with each of them, I said the same thing. You're giving me your Human Rights Award, and you're giving me your Young Achiever Award. You do know you sacked me 10 years ago for the very thing that you've never done before. And I share that again because it's about if you stay true to yourself, you will succeed. So 15 years later, the most precious thing are not those numbers, are the 12,000 people seeking asylum that have come through our door. 12,000 people. Thousands of those people are alive because of this community. I don't think of us as an organization, I think of us as a movement. Now, there's a lot of darkness in this space, yeah? There's a lot of darkness in this space. And I have no interest in spending the night telling you a horror story. You've all got parts of it in your mind here. You know, just summarizing, that on Manus Island, we've killed more of the men seeking our protection than we've settled. You know on Nauru, we're allowing women and children to be sexually abused. And that's what gave me the insight into how the child abuse in churches was possible for so long. I was like, how did they get away with it for so long? Deny, 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 spin, 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 minimize, minimize, minimize. And then have no political opposition, no opposition. We know this is happening. We know at the moment, in Brisbane, a couple of days ago, people reading up the Nauru files, just an endless trove of horror. Today, figures came out saying that we had spent $9.6 billion since 2013 to lock up refugees. And we're going to spend $5.7 billion more in the next 4 years. So I did the numbers, And for that $9.6 billion, which is almost twice UNHCR's global budget to help 65 million people, we spent that to lock up a couple of thousand people. And for that same money, we could have settled safely, completely, from refugee camps, 161,000 people, fully funded. I was having a conversation before outside, and people were saying that the Nauru files aren't shifting the poles. And how is that possible? How is it possible there are some 30,000 people seeking asylum in the community right now who have had 90% of their legal assistance cut? For the first couple of years, they were left without even the right to work, and all these people have been waiting 4 years just to apply for asylum. How? How? How is it possible that we're spending $400,000, $500,000 a year just to lock a person up? The cost of locking up 20 kids on the Nauru is the annual budget of the ACC for an entire year. Or a good example was, last week we had the state governor of Victoria commit $15 million to enable 3,000 people seeking asylum to go to TAFE. And I contrasted that, 3,000 people, and I say to you, for $15 million, we can invest in 3,000 resilient, courageous people who will give back to this country. Or for the same $15 million, you can take the Malcolm Turnbull option, and that will fund 30 men being locked up on Manus for a year. Which would you like to invest in? But none of this is cutting through. Appeals to international law are not cutting through. What we're doing is illegal. To today, 9.6, that's the budget of Gonski for the first couple of years. Do you think there was any outrage in the community? Nauru files, did it tip the majority of Australians the other way? So the horror isn't shifting the national opinion. It's changing, but it is shifting, but not to the level we need it to. The economics of it, where we've been told there's a budget crisis, is not changing things. The appeals to international law aren't really working. Who's tried myth-busting on this issue before? Anyone tried myth-busting? Who's got a racist relative in their family? Put your hand up. Okay. Who's tried using myth-busting with your racist relative? Who succeeded using myth-busting? We spent almost 15 years, I was the king of myth-busting. Thinking, but if I bust the myth, people are rational and people are reasonable. This sets me up nicely. The idea that people are rational and reasonable. Remember this when it comes to human rights. Fear trumps fact every single day of the week. Fear trumps fact every single day of the week. So if you're sitting there and you're myth-busting, you're sitting there saying, but there's no queue, and they're not illegal, and they're not terrorists, and there's so few. Why is it not working? One of our biggest mistakes when we talk about human rights is we talk about it here. Put up your hand if the important decisions in your life are decided here or here. Put up your hand if they're decided here, and put up your hand if they're decided there. So who makes the decisions, you know, 9 out of 10 based on their head? Put up your hand. Who does it based on their heart, their feelings? Put up your hand. We're emotional creatures. And we're sitting here trying to engage in fact and abstract. And we're having these esoteric conversations about the Refugee Convention and the Geneva Convention and the International Declaration of Human Rights. And guess how many people give a shit about those things? Not many. Not most. Guess how many people know what the hell you're talking about when you quote international law? Not many. Not most. Guess how the economic argument, the figures I just quoted you, in any other area would bring down a government. But here people are like, if that's the price, if that's the price, we'll have to pay it. If that's the price, we'll have to pay it. Because we are in a space right now where we are being told that this depravity and these brutal policies are necessary. These are a necessary evil. That we must have this. That we've exhausted everything. I'll summarise that question quickly for you, because it's good for you to have it, because I know I'm with people who information matters and you are interested in facts. So I'll summarise some critical things, but this is not going to change things either. We haven't even started. We haven't even started. So we're being sold the fiction that we need to be brutal to stop boats and to turn people back and to take sugar off the table. Here's how we haven't even started. We've cut our refugee intake by 31%. We're going to save 20,500 less people's lives between 2013 and 2019. We've stopped entire safe resettlement from Indonesia of UNHCR SIS refugees since July 1, 2014. We take less refugees now than we did under Paul Keating. Our foreign aid is the lowest in recorded history. Foreign aid being critical in building human rights mechanisms, frameworks, and where is foreign aid most important? In protecting the human rights of women in countries that are developing those systems around gender equality. And what have we gone and done? We just cut it. We had countries like New Zealand offer to take 300 of those men on manors. We don't let them go. Because we wanted them to experience something so brutal that they dismantled all their hope. We have open trade with countries that violate human rights, like Vietnam and Sri Lanka, and we don't use our trade for good. We have no national dialogue. We have no regional framework. One of my friends was the late Malcolm Fraser. And when we would talk about this, he would sit there and say, I had the pressure to lock people up, I had the pressure to turn boats back, but I actually built a process. And he was able to resettle 250,000 people. Quickly, timely, transparently. We have no process. We have no safe passage. We have no intake numbers that even scratch the surface of what we're capable of. We've cut almost all our foreign aid. We once safely resettled people from our region. We haven't even started. And yet we've been told this is as good as it gets. So why aren't we winning? And how do we start winning? So we found ourselves after 14 years going, we're sick of losing. We are sick of not being able to cut through. We are sick of not being able to change the conversation. So we went out there and did research, spoke to over 3,000 people across three states. And what we found was everything we were doing was making it worse. Maybe not to our base, like educated people appreciated the facts and the economics and the international law. You know, when you're sitting there with your friends and you're having your soy latte and your cigarette and going, what a dreadful man that he has done it is. But you step out of your little bubble and that narrative and conversation is going nowhere. And what we found through our research of focus group and dial testing and phone calling thousands of people was all our work and our narrative and conversation was making it worse. And it was making our ability to protect the human rights of people seeking asylum much more difficult. Because what we were failing to do was talk about human rights from a model of values and morals. Put up your hand if your life decisions are guided by your values and morals. Now leave your hands up if your values and morals are more important than a fact someone shares with you. So we sat there and found our research. All the things we do. These people are not illegal. These people are not queue jumpers. These people are not terrorists. There's only this many boats. Do you know how long it would take to fill up the MCG? There's only been one person found to be a terrorist in 40 years. What were we doing? We were actually reinforcing the dominant narrative of our opposition. We were actually sitting there and helping our opposition win. Because what do you hear when I say they're not terrorists? So they could be. And what do you hear about when I say they're not queue jumpers? Well, so there is a queue. And what is it? What do you hear when I say they're not illegal? So they are breaking the law. Well, what about if I just rely on economic arguments? So there's a price point where torture and human rights abuses is acceptable. So what we found is that ourselves and our movement was actually part of the problem. that we have this well-intentioned but naive idea that you can actually protect and champion human rights through fact and appeals to law and economics. It's not to say that they don't have a role, but only in your base. So what did our research show? We found 20% were our base, ready to go, fired up, probably lots of the sort of people in this room tonight. And they were predominantly women, educated, and 18 to 35. There was 24% that were like, one nation is the second coming, Pauline Hanson is an intellectual giant, she speaks the truth, yes, we want an inquiry into Islam. Now that 24%, and I know they're not all, but we're predominantly white, Anglo, older, uneducated men. And what our research showed is don't waste your time with that 24%. Honestly, they just need to kind of die out. They kind of do. I'm not advocating you do anything to progress that, I'm just saying they just kind of need to die out. But what was really heartening in our research is that it showed that 56% of Australians were persuaded, that they were persuadable, that you could actually shift the conversation, and that they were willing to change their attitudes on refugees if you use the right frame, the right values, and the right conversation. This is huge, because if you look at every critical movement, from land rights, to the struggle for pay equality, to the struggles of the women's movement, to the struggles of marriage equality, to global struggles around apartheid and segregation, at the heart, what do they all share in common? Humanizing the oppressed. Can you think of any of those movements making progress without that? None. Humanizing the oppressed. Humanizing in a way where they exist in your moral universe and your values universe, where you look at that and go, actually, that's not okay. So, how do we change things? Well, what we're doing as an organisation is we're actually going across Australia over the next couple of years, and we're going to train up thousands of people sharing our tools and our learnings from this research, from our Words That Work research, and build an army of people to go out there and empower their own communities to change the conversation. We're only going to get there if we as a community demand better and expect better. Now, the irony of watching a multicultural community here tonight and yet seeing the rise of one nation on the idea that immigration and migrants and refugees are a burden and a threat, and the ability to appropriate real social issues around unemployment and the environment, and then go, all these things, that life you wish you had, it's these migrants, it's these people of colour, it's these Muslims, when ironically, they're the communities that do the jobs that most Australians won't touch, that revive regional and rural areas, and that bring that entrepreneurship that's helped make this country great along with our First Nations people. So how are we going to do things differently? And how might we start that different conversation? Okay. Here's how we can start doing it differently. And here's how we can start changing the conversation with refugees. And this stuff is powerful. This research, within us launching it last October, the following organisations completely changed how they talk about this issue based on their research. GetUp, MSF, Amnesty International, Human Rights Law Centre, every one of them, using that research, and there's about 24, where we return to a conversation around values. So what do I mean? Think of that race as relative and imagine two conversations. Conversation number one is sitting there going, grandfather, what's happening to refugees is awful. These people are not illegal. These people are not queue jumpers. Do you know under this section of the Refugee Convention, seeking asylum is a human right? And do you know how much it costs us? These people are not terrorists and these people are an asset. And how many of you think it's going to convince your racist relative? It's not. But imagine a values-based narrative of grandfather. Do you remember when you came to this country? Do you remember the sacrifice you made? And do you remember the grief and loss of that journey? And do you remember coming here and being told that you weren't wanted? I remember my parents telling me this, you know, that Greeks being spat on in the streets in the 50s and 60s and thought the F off. Everyone has those stories. Indigenous people have those stories since the time of invasion. You know, grandfather, do you remember how hard you worked to contribute to this country? And how proud you are of the children that you've raised? Because you wanted a better life for them. That's what these people want. Their story is yours. Which do you think is going to engage your grandfather or your uncle or your cousin? It's going to be a conversation about values. So what we're talking about is about how do we start naming it. So when the Labor Party came out and said, well, it's awful what's happening on Nauru, and they said, okay, so we're going to shut it down. Like, no, but we've got a great plan. We're going to send in an independent child advocate. It's an amazing plan. It's an amazing policy. So I was on the BBC a few weeks ago after the Labor puppet was saying this stuff. And I go to the person, I go, so let me explain the Labor government's policy from a values point of view. Imagine if I told you right now there was a church or a school in your neighbourhood where you knew children being sexually abused. And I gave you two choices. Choice one, evacuate those children immediately. Or choice two, send in someone to document a report or future child abuse that's about to happen. Which would you choose? Suddenly you cut through the bullshit. I now say to people, do you think child abuse is acceptable under certain circumstances? Of course not. Well, under any circumstances? Never. Then how can you support what is happening on the roof? Do you think torture is acceptable under any circumstances? Of course not. Then how can you accept what is happening on Manus? What our research showed is the most important thing we need to do is we need to return to values, and we need to stop talking about what refugees are not. I'll probably need to take a couple more minutes. What refugees are not, and actually start talking about what refugees are. Because when we're talking about it in a negative, and we're using terms like asylum seeker, we don't use that anymore. Anyone relate to that label? No. I'm actually taking away your empathy, asylum seeker. We're actually talking about people seeking safety. Yeah, I get that. People seeking a better life. People seeking asylum. We're not using nationalistic words like Australians can do better than this. Our research shows us that it actually feeds the idea of borders. And instead we talk about caring people, kind people, compassionate people. Because everyone wants to be that aspirational language. We talk a little bit about why people flee, but not too much. Guess why the Nauru stuff wasn't cutting through? When people are seeing the horror of either what they've fled or what's happening in those detention centers, you know what the average Australian is thinking? They're not thinking about the fact that these people are being systematically tortured and it's not their fault. They're thinking they're going to bring those problems here. So if you get focused on almost like a horror narrative, you're actually disengaging those persuadables because they're sitting there thinking they're going to bring those problems here. So we use language around things like people seeking asylum want to integrate. What's your position going to say to that? I actually don't want those people integrating. People seeking asylum want to contribute. What are they going to say? No, they don't want them to. People seeking asylum share our values. They're refugees because they believe in democracy and equality. That's why they've been persecuted in the first place. So you are going to build a movement that engages people if you use a language that focuses on values where we can identify. It's incredible when we have young people getting up there and talking about the things they're passionate about, from the love of Instagram to their, I still can't fathom their love of Justin Bieber. And suddenly, seriously, how? And suddenly the young people in the audience are like, oh, I love my Instagram, I love my Bieber. How do you feel about Riri? And suddenly there's a conversation going. What I'm getting at is suddenly you're bringing them into a circle that you actually identify with. And it's amazing when young people in particular, not just young people, every generation come up in contact with people with lived experience of seeking asylum and go, oh, these people just love their families. Oh, these people are hardworking. These people just want to put food on the table. They're grateful to be here, and they want to contribute. Suddenly you start talking about it from a values point of view, and keeping it local. What happens when we talk about 65 million in the scale to the person that's in that persuadable space? They're not going to move. They're like, oh, you think we can take them all now? Don't make it too big. You've got to keep it local. And go, in our region right now, we could easily take four times as many people. Right now. And we could make it safe. And just to wrap up in the last couple of minutes, when people throw to you things like the boats and the smugglers, I actually stop people live on air now and typically go, can we have a real conversation, please? And why are you asking the wrong questions? And we're not talking about boats, we're talking about people. And I'm not interested in smugglers. They're not the issue. They weren't after World War II. People are just grateful we got people out. People are going, oh, what a shame people were rescued from the Nazis by those awful smugglers. They just said, well, think about it. So when we're having this conversation now, I sit and go, it's not about smugglers. There's no sugar on the table. These are people escaping harm, seeking safety. And if people believe in the preciousness of life, then the saving of a life is a universal moral good. And so when people start with that, I just sit and go, can we start with a real conversation? Can we start with one of the following sentences that you wouldn't have heard Malcolm Turnbull or Bill Shorten utter? How do we help more people? How do we save more lives? How do we provide safe passage? How do we prevent people from dying at sea by safely resettling them en masse? How do we make use of that incredible entrepreneurship and resilience and put it to good use? Now, refugees shouldn't have to be exceptional to get that protection either. They should be able to be as mediocre as One Nation supporters. No one asked them to be exceptional, to have their freedom. But once we start talking about human rights from a values point of view, and we start talking about universal shared narratives and journeys, what I started with tonight about the people that have sacrificed for you and your moments of despair, when we start with us, when we start by teaching empathy before we teach international law, when we start talking about values before we rely on facts, that we stop and actually ask people to reflect on who they are and own that rather than be dogmatic. When we start engaging people in a conversation. And I want to say to you, do not lose hope. There is a movement that is rising, both in terms of the incredible resilience and courage of people with experience who are speaking out everywhere across this country, to this incredible grassroots movement of tens of thousands of Australians across this country. Opinion polls are shifting, and people are growing increasingly restless and disturbed by what is being done in our name. We can win this. We can succeed. If we keep leading with values, claim the moral high ground, offer solutions, engage people around shared conversations around what we share in common, share stories of what refugees are, avoid labels, focus on that shared story. People love being aspirational. We can make this country proud again to offer a refuge and sanctuary to refugees. We can be proud again as a country. We can do this. We know money's not the issue. Law's not the issue. Capacity and space is not the issue. What we are lacking is leadership. That's where we're bankrupt in this country. So it's going to have to come from me and you. And it's going to take time. There's 20 years of this. But if we see it, and if we live our values, and if we champion it, and if we're idealistic, and we walk that journey side by side with people who are seeking asylum, we can get to a point where one day no one touches this other election, except for Prime Minister to get up and to apologise. And imagine that speech. A Prime Minister getting up, you know, my final words of, you know, we apologise for the lives stolen, the futures that were forsaken, the children harmed simply for political greed. And we recommit to be a country that takes pride in protecting people seeking safety and that celebrates our humanity and decency as a country and that seizes that incredible opportunity to do what is right and also what will be great for this country. This is who we are going to be going forward. And that same program is actually linking that and actually going, and we're going to do justice by our First Nations people. We can have that country. We've just got to want it enough and be willing to fight for it. And out there, you know, tomorrow you're going to have lots of cynical people. F them. They're not changing anything. They're not going to change it. Anyone can be cynical, too hard or too difficult. What we need are people who are sitting there going, I can see that this country can be greater and better. And I'm going to help make that happen. Wherever that sits, in whatever little way. Leave your footprint on this earth that is one that has made this world better and fairer and kinder. Make your own legacy. These were the things that you remember in the last moments of pride. I will stop there because I've gone over time. And we're going to turn it over to you for some questions. So I want to say thank you for listening to me. So in any particular order, throw out your questions. I might just, can I take this off?
Please do. And there's a roving mic as well, if people would like the roving mic.
That back.
Yep, questions?
Hi, Kon. My name's Jackie. I'm an occupational therapy student looking into how the language that we use impacts people's abilities to actually participate in society, right? So I would really love to know how, on a daily level, how are you empowering people on a practical level to overcome the language that is labelled on them by Australian society?
One of the critical things, you're still okay? So one of the critical things we're doing at the ASRC that we historically weren't great at, we weren't even good at, was about the voices of people with lived experience, people who actually have sought asylum. So in the last 2 years, we've overhauled our entire organisation and said, if we're going to be talking about this, where are the voices of people who have been refugees? Remembering it's a moment in time. So now in our centre, there are 150 weekly volunteers that are people seeking asylum. So they're helping run their organisation, as in, you are the experts, you have the knowledge, you're going to run it with us. We overhauled our recruitment procedures so that 50% of our paid staff in our, you know, in our World First Innovation Hub are people from asylum seeker backgrounds. And actually go, when we're recruiting people, not going, oh, well, you don't have Australian work experience, we're actually going, what is the cultural and social capital that you're bringing? How precious that is, that cultural and social capital connection. Every time we do a panel in Melbourne, and when I was in Brisbane, and what I was doing in Sydney, is in all those panels where we have a series of speakers like that, on every panel we make sure there's a person with lived experience as part of that panel. The other weekend, we were training up 8 young people in our Advocacy and Power program who are going to be, over 4 months, who are going to be future leaders for our country. Our Advocacy and Power program. We have our Youth Action Network, bringing together young people seeking asylum with everyday young Australians and bringing that empowerment community together. We're funding our first ever paid internship programs. A quarter of our board are people from refugee backgrounds. So on every level, from board representation to senior leadership, to our volunteer base, to our paid staff, to our voices, to our interns, to our future leaders. So how we're shifting this is going, the more and more we're able to do that, in our innovation hub, which we love, it's picture a huge 1,200 square metre business hub that you walk into it and the first conversation with people seeking asylum is, who are you going to be? And what is your dream? For some, it's like, I want to do a paid internship. Well, we've got a couple going at the moment, or a paid job. Would you like to go and have an experience working at ESOP or Telstra or SportsGuild? Because they have all these companies going, these people are an asset. Well, would you like to be part of our youth leadership program, our women's empowerment program, our social entrepreneurs network, helping dozens of people right now start their own businesses while they're still seeking asylum? So for us, it's about, we see so much value in business because we're shifting it, which is actually the narrative around, we are an asset and a resource and we can speak for ourselves. And so this is work, and we're just getting started. We've got about 10 initiatives at the moment, because this is one of the things in any space you're working, having worked for decades, you know, as a social worker as well, when you're working with your community, When you're working with your community, it is so important to go, where is the self-determination of that community to speak for itself? You know, I have the honour of being on an Aboriginal Children's Board organisation, and when I'm up in Jabiru, you sit there, and what I love about the model that we have at Children's Ground is Indigenous self-determination, Indigenous knowledge systems, Indigenous control of what is happening day in, day out. How rare is that in areas of disability, in homelessness, in women's services? So often it is the person at the end is seen as deficient and passive. And so what we end up doing unintentionally in the caring professions is we actually create a savior complex, and we end up treating the people we're meant to actually be empowering, who actually don't need empowerment. I have to be careful with that word. I was talking to my volunteers last week going, people seeking asylum are the most resilient people on earth. They're a hell of a lot more resilient than any of you. And they're a hell of a lot resilient than any of our paid staff. And that's really important, because we're always looking at them as somehow weak or less, when in fact it's a circumstance that have put them in this moment in time. So that's some of the work we're doing. Other questions?
In 1992, I was traveling with Australian visa, and I had been taken from the bus on Croatian boundary and Slovenian boundary, because what they have seen in the passport, they have seen my name. In 2016, my son has changed name into an Anglo-Saxon's name, already in Australia. What we see is in the society that we discriminate people by age. You are 50, you can't get a job. Discriminate people by religion, discriminate people by this, discriminate people by that. How can we change that?
I think part of it is about naming it and speaking out about it. So one of the important things is going, if you're against racism, then you're against sexism, then you're against homophobia, then you're against ageism. You're against discrimination against people with special needs. And I think it's about how do we take back that language. It's that conversation around cutting your name. God knows how many times people told me, why don't you shorten your name? And going, why would I forsake my culture? And so one of the beautiful things is that space is shifting. More and more you see young people of ethnic backgrounds, young people of colour, you see young First Nations people, more and more people are challenging it. So I really do think with this, it's about how do we support each other. Where we're not, why the hell are we the ones meant to be assimilated? If we're going to be assimilated to anything, it should be to First Nations cultures and languages and traditions. You know, so what are we assimilating to? And this idea of this melting pot, and it's really interesting, like they love to fetishize us, exoticize us, and appropriate our cultures like we're a second skin. Oh, we love your, you know, oh, your food, or your dancing, or your beautiful this. And it's like, the minute you want to share your culture, your politics, or your values, oh, no, this is Australia. So we need to actually start claiming who we are, being proud of who we are, and stop defending who we are. Some of the talks I'm having at the moment with the Muslim community in Melbourne is going, we would love to support you and stop talking about what Muslims are not. Poor Muslim community, every time some idiot decides to claim their act of violence under Allah, suddenly every Muslim's on, you know, under the scope. You know, I want to go around the streets now and go up to white Anglo men and go, I saw another woman killed the other day. What have you got to say about it? I'm waiting for moderate white male leaders to come out and condemn that. What have you got to say about that? We need to stop defending who we are. We need to start talking about who we are unapologetically and be proud of it. So I think that's how we shift it. And that's how it is shifting. Because I understand that most of my cousins have shortened their name, have assimilated in different ways. This idea somehow of Angloness and whiteness is somehow the aspiration. We need to just flip that and go, no, this hairiness and that wog name of mine, I'm really proud of it. So we need to claim who we are and be proud of it and be supporting each other and have solidarity in that we don't just go, as long as I'm okay in my space. And one of the most difficult things is some of the most conservative communities are migrant communities. Some of the greatest conservatism, my mum's often defending me. You know, going, oh, your son, you know, when's he going to become a real lawyer? And what does he do this work? And we came the right way. And there is so much trauma in the migrant and refugee experience that the minute you're finally a good wog, you know, like you're Greek, you're Italian, the Indians have got through that threshold, maybe the Sri Lankans, once you tick that box, those communities are sitting there and going, the last thing I want my children to ever do is to stand out. Like how many friends I have whose parents won't even teach them their language? Because they're scared of them standing out. Because they're going, and the parents quite seriously go, I'm scared you're going to be rounded up. You're going to get deported. Because they've lived that journey. So there is so much unresolved trauma that results in so many people in the migrant community themselves not wanting to identify with refugees out of the fear of being the other and being persecuted or unwanted again, because that's what they've been through already. We need to stop playing each other off against one another. These are on the same common ground of human rights, whether it's your rights as a woman, or as a First Nations person, or as a person seeking asylum. We need to be talking about a human rights narrative where we all have a seat at the table. And that's really, once we start amplifying each other's voices and being allies to each other, that's really powerful. Other questions?
One of the greatest voices of the opposition to is the media and the gross misrepresentation of asylum seekers. I mean, you look at the Paris bomber latest terrorist attack, and within the same breath, they mention how many refugees have come into Paris and stuff like that. And immediately, you're looking at, like, you're comparing, okay, refugees means terrorism and stuff like that. How do we combat that? How do we get a voice in over the top of that?
We actually stop talking about it. I'm being quite serious. That this is an interesting thing. So there has been, four times more women killed since 2010 by the violence of men than Australians killed by terrorism in 119 years. 536 women, I think. Are men on the line? Are people walking around asking moderate men to come out and speak up for men with progressive masculinities? For the progressive and moderate men? I'm not being facetious. I'm saying we're not problematizing men as a whole, even though we should be problematizing the way we're raising men with such dysfunctional, misogynistic masculinity. We're not doing that because we see men as complete creatures in our universe, in our families, with values, with identities, and we relate to them. So when one man does something wrong, we don't sit there and taint all men in the same brush, do we? No. So what is it about the fact you just need one? You just need one person who's from a refugee background in Europe to be connected to something. One. One out of 6 million Syrians just needs one. And what that tells you is how fragile it is. How fragile the way in which we don't see them as people. That we can take one person, they can speak for 6 million. In America, the CIA has found that white extremism, white Christian extremists, white Christian fundamentalists, are the greatest terrorist threat to the United States. No one's talking about whiteness there. In fact, for a man who knees down, a footballer, against black deaths in the US, people are talking about boycotting an entire sport. Because a man of color is exercising his democratic right. What I'm getting at is we need to stop defending what we are not and who we are not. When that Bill Lee cartoon came out, that disgusting piece of racist hate speech, and the press council gutlessly said it was okay. It sat there caricaturing indigenous men as lazy, savage-like creatures. And what was beautiful was then, what did the indigenous community come out with? Indigenous dads. I don't know if you saw that on Twitter. It was beautiful. Actually talking about their fathers from a place of strength and pride. That's what I'm talking about. We need to be talking about who we are and what we stand for and our values and our contribution. We need to stop even touching those conversations. I refuse to debate people around those issues anymore because you cannot win. And I don't want you to win because it just takes one. It just takes one. You know, it's incredible that it's only if you're a person of color or indigenous or Muslim that somehow you have the extraordinary power to speak for an entire people for your rights. Only whiteness has a right to speak for themselves.
What a privilege.
But it is. And we need to name that and we need to call that. You know, if the truth hurts, then you're going to be in pain. And we need to not be afraid to be disrupting and challenging it. We do not have to accept this anymore. You know, at the moment, the Racial Discrimination Act is up in the air. 20 senators, what do they all share in common? Yeah. Sitting and going, Australia's not hateful enough. We need more freedom. We need to speak out because They go after that. That's going after the indigenous community, the Jewish community, the Muslim community, the gay community, the refugee community. They're coming after all of us. Anyone that doesn't fit this sort of narrow caricature of some fantasy land out of Neighbours. Where's that Australia? Look around you. Where's that Australia? Where the hell do you see yourselves represented right now in this country? In government? On television? Where do you see yourselves represented in ways that make you proud outside of your own community and your relationships with your family and your friends? Where do you see yourselves publicly represented in public spheres of power? Almost never, yeah? So you need to change that, and you're doing that now. You're the future professionals, doctors, lawyers, teachers, architects, engineers. You're changing that space. Women are changing that space, people of colour are changing that space, Indigenous people are changing that space. We need to just keep changing that space. We need to take that power. It's never going to be given to us. And it's changing. Because I'm sick and tired of where is that representation. Aren't you tired? Aren't you tired of the only time people talk about your faith or your colour or your identity is when they want to talk about it as a problem? Aren't you tired of that? Don't you want a different story, a new narrative to be spoken of? That's the one we're going to write. That's the one we're going to speak of. We do not have to play by the rules of our opposition. We do not have to cower to those who don't see us as human. And be grateful for whatever breadcrumbs they give us. No more. And once we start from that position of expectation and of equality, there's no going back. That's where we have to start. Other questions? Yes.
My name's Femi. I was just wondering, with refugees, I feel like although we try and relocate them to safety, do you think that we should also address the actual cause of these refugees? Because I feel that we support these governments doing policies that actually bomb areas, cause refugees, but we're denying that our actions have no effect. So do you think that that's a possible avenue that we could kind of consider?
Of course. And one of the real challenges at the moment are that historically the countries that are meant to hold the moral sort of integrity, like, you know, what is Australia doing? And what is the United States doing? And what is the UK doing? We've created a moral vacuum. Who's going to... We had last year North Korea and Iran and China lecturing us on human rights. What a bitch slap. They're sitting there and they're like, North Korea, who's starving its people, sitting there going, you're awful, Australia. Think about how embarrassing that is. Because they sit there and go, you can't lecture us. You lock up refugees on torture islands. Yeah, you can't lecture us. The United States right now is bombing 7 different nations in the Middle East. I don't think almost no one in this audience even knows that. 7 different countries right now. September 11th, as tragic as that was, all I heard has been spoken about were the lives lost in the United States, not the 1.1 million Iraqi people that died from that fictitious illegal war. So of course we need to get to the root cause of why are we creating those refugees in the first place. And when we start seeing the impact of climate change, as resources get more scarce, and as people are displaced further, and it creates more vacuums with the as we take less and less people, and we cut more and more of our foreign aid, where is our moral authority? At the moment, what Peter Dutton's working on is everything from saying to the men on Manus, 98% of which have been found to be refugees, you can either stay here and probably get beaten to death, you can go to Malaysia and just live there on the run, or you can, we'll voluntarily help you go home where you can be killed. Because that's all that stuff is, you know, stop the boats, turn back the boats, just about die somewhere else, just we don't want our conscience pricked. So we have to go back to the thing around where is diplomacy? How do we use trade? How do we use aid? How do we lead by example? How do we stop creating refugees? See, they're dropping bombs in countries like Syria, they're like, why are these people fleeing? We drop bombs in Afghanistan, Iraq, what are these people doing at our doorstep? And then we go, what do we do? Instead of settling tens of thousands more, we spend hundreds of millions of dollars doing ads. The only time you ever get anything in different language from immigration is when it's telling you to F off. You know, do not come here. You're not welcomed here. You'll never make Australia home. That's the message we're sending. So yeah, we need to be going back to the root cause of why do we have refugees in the first place? and the way in which human rights abuses at the heart are about what happens when democracy is denied, and when civil institutions are repressed, and when freedom of speech, freedom of media, freedom of movement, equality for women. But we need to also stop demonizing people. We need to stop demonizing. I've traveled a lot through the Middle East, and every time I've gone to the Middle East, I keep having people coming up to me going, "Why does your country hate us?" And they're so generous and so proud and so welcoming. I remember my happiest moment was more than a decade ago when I was in Syria. The kindest, most generous people on earth. Why does your country hate us? We are not terrorists, we are good people. When we sit there and continue to demonize people, we also help feed that. We help feed that sense of displacement and isolation, rather than actually go, these are corrupt governments. And just like the one that's running Guantanamo Bay at the moment has tortured God knows how many people there in the United States. We need to stop having this imperialist colonialist attitude that somehow, you know, Western democracy knows all, and keep forcing it onto the rest of the world. Anyway, don't get me started on that. But we need to tackle the root causes.
30 years' time, and they're right about us now.
I think they're going to sit and go, what the hell is going on? Like, when I go, when I get a chance, and I've had a few scholarships in the last couple of years, and I've got to go across North America and Europe, and people just shake their heads, going, what the hell is wrong with your country? We have never seen a country so hysterical and so irrational and so obsessed with borders like your country is. You take so few. What is this about? I think he's just going to look at us as, this is going to look at us as one of the darkest chapters in our nation's history. It's going to look at the last 20 years and the tens of thousands of people that this country has brutalized under the lie that we're being kept safe. And it's going to damn us for it. And that's why, you know, for me, in terms of, you know, continuing to speak out and being passionate about some things later, is I want to be on the right side of that history. It actually matters being on the right side of history. And I want to know, you know, look back and be able to say, yeah, I was, you know, they're speaking out when it mattered, as were so many other people. History's not going to look at us kindly. No one's going to be sitting there in the history books and going, you know, Malcolm Turnbull, you know, proudly took the most vulnerable, persecuted, oppressed people on earth and bravely sent them to camps to be tortured and raped until they set themselves on fire. And, you know, we will forever be grateful for that leadership. No one's writing that footnote, are they? No one's going to be sitting there going, oh, but in 2012, the opinion poll said this was the right thing to do. To sit there and allow children to be sexually abused, funded, controlled, managed and under the watch of our government. No one's going to be writing about that in any way but to damn us for it, as they bloody should. And what I dream of, but it's never going to bloody happen, is for all these bastards, from Dutton to Morrison to Abbott, all of them to end up at the Hague. That's where they all bloody belong. But sadly, it's not going to happen. Because in countries like ours, we're the good guys. But that's where they all bloody belong, in the Hague.
It's one more question.
Challenging space, because, you know, those, while I was talking down international law, I was talking it down because it's not actually going to shift the persuadables that we need to. You know, things like the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Refugee Convention, are really precious documents because they're actually about aspiring to us as a global community, about our learnings from the horrors of the past and never repeat them again. But the problem with all these major big organizations, from the UN to the UNHCR, is the way in which so often they become such massive bureaucracies with so many different masters and they're toothless tigers. Like, we're signatories of the Convention Against Torture, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, CEDWA, in terms of the elimination of discrimination against women, and yet we're doing all these things. And the difficulty is what actually needs to be happening is the global community needs to actually have sanctions against our country. Like they did with South Africa. That's what we deserve when it comes to treating refugees. But who's going to do that? And one of the difficult things is, over the last two decades, have you seen the way, on the one hand, Australia's trying to get a seat on the Human Rights Committee, Yeah. And on the second hand, they are sitting there constantly bashing the United Nations, UNHCR. For all their flaws, they're the best we've got. And what's so troubling and problematic is when they sit there and constantly undermine one's faith in them. Just like they did last year with Gillian Triggs and the Australian Human Rights Commission, where they take national or international institutions that are independent and are there to be watchdogs to protect human rights, and they sit there and they politicise them, and they mock them, and they undermine them. So I'd say, remember Abbott sitting and saying it's not for the UN to dictate to us, you know, what we do. And when he was asked about torture in Sri Lanka, he was like, well, you know, in difficult times, difficult things happen. Basically, shit happens. So it's really problematic because they do have a role to play. We clearly need a Bill of Rights in this country. When you look at Europe with the European Bill of Human Rights, and you look at the European Court of Human Rights, clearly we need something. It's not going to happen anytime soon, but we do need a Bill of Rights, a Charter of Rights. We do need something that we can return to. And what we've got at the moment is failing. And even with the High Court, the difficulty is consistently, every time there's a court ruling in this space that protects people's review rights or appeal rights or how people can be treated, continuously they just keep shifting the goalposts and keep amending the law. And it becomes really hard when the High Court, it's standing at the moment, is that it is legal in this country to indefinitely detain a child, a woman, or a man forever in our detention centres, even if you've got no prospect of removing them, which is what we're doing at the moment on Manus. Ironically, the Supreme Court of Manus Island knows it's unconstitutionally legal, because they sit there saying you're basically trafficking people, and these people aren't being processed and aren't being settled. This is illegal. They get it. We don't get it. So they are important institutions, but they have so little power, you know, and so little say. And the real problem is they have no teeth. And so people can cherry pick it when it suits them, when it's good for PR. But the rest of the time, sit there and they do that thing of dumbing us down, that elitist stuff. All that lefty leaders, latte sipping people who don't like children being sexually abused and tortured. You know. And this is, but I'm quite serious. You see the way they mock this by sitting there and saying that somehow it's elitist to want to have a country where everyone has human rights and where everyone is equal. And that it's optional to give it to some and to not give it to others. That's deeply disturbing, isn't it? And that's what we need to change. I think we're done. Actually, these workshops we're talking about, I actually look to come back and run one for people who are interested, to actually share with you the tools and the learnings and the how-to that you can take out into your own community. So really keen to continue that conversation. You can also get in touch with me through social media, through Twitter and Facebook.
May I invite you to the Thinkers Festival in Chartersdale next time you're here?
Okay, that sounds good.
Any other things? First Thinkers Festival.
Okay, thank you. And I'm happy to stay back for a little bit before I go have some dinner and answer any other questions that people didn't feel comfortable asking in a big group. Thank you again for your hospitality. Stay passionate and curious and fearless, and you can change the world. You really can. So I encourage you to do that in a beautiful way. Thank you so much.
Everyone here, I'd just like to make a donation to the work of this Asylum Seeker Resource
Centre.
It's so great to hear what Kon shared with us, but I think what's come through is his passion and the importance of doing something, not just sitting there. So I think, we could be giving out bits of paper, but all of you know the resources, the Asylum Seeker Resource Centre. You can Google the website, see what Kon's group are doing. Amnesty International, all the groups are doing things. If you feel strongly about the sorts of things Kon's talked about, get involved with one of the groups. There's the groups we talked about earlier, they're all easily accessible. If you want to get contact or an emailing list, come see me or one of the Amnesty group members, put your hands up over there, ask those people there. They can get your email address, you can be on the Amnesty email list. But please keep in contact and let's support Kon and the wonderful things that he's been doing.
And remember tonight, there were also people talking about all the other volunteer opportunities, from writing to people in detention, to doing fundraisers for local organisations, they're helping out at the local refugee migrant resource centre here. Connect to your local community. There's nothing better than giving your time and goodwill to your local community, whether it's helping Amnesty, the wonderful work that you heard the students talking about before, that they're doing through their health group, supporting people in the community or supporting people in detention. Do something. Just pick something, start anywhere, and it all adds up. It all really does help. So I'm sure you can share all that and not to anyone. Thank you again, everyone.